Thank you. Oh, I'm Leif Nixon. I have been doing things to computers for many years. These days, my daytime work is at Sectra Communications in Linköping, where we monitor and protect critical infrastructure, the industrial control systems in important places. But a fun thing in the light of the previous presentation is that our sister company, Sectra Medical, is one of the leading vendors of PACS systems. There is a reason why there are only four visible PACS servers in Sweden. It's because we have shut them down. So there are people actually looking for these things. But anyway, over to the French case. I mean, the title in the agenda says tainted crime scene because I had to have something more descriptive. But me and my former colleagues always refer to it as the French case. This is when I was working in academia at the National Supercomputer Center at Linköping University. But to give some context, we have to go to Geneva. This is an aerial picture of the outskirts of Geneva. You see Lake Geneva in the upper right and the airport to the right. The white circle is LHC, the Large Hadron Collider. It's a tunnel about 100 meters underground where protons are accelerated to near light speed in both directions at once through the circle, through the tunnel. And then these bunches of protons are intersect and collide at four places around the ring, the four experiment sites, which are the names. The yellow line is the border between France and Switzerland, which has interesting legal complications. I could talk for quite some time about LHC because it's a very cool place, but I don't have time for that, unfortunately. The thing you need to know is that LHC produces data. Lots of data, humongous amounts of data. CERN itself can't take care of all the data, so there's a global network of tier one sites on almost all continents that cooperate to store, receive, and store the data when the accelerator is running. And the GF down at the bottom left is the Scandinavian center for dealing with this. So there are typically dedicated 100 gigabit lines between the tier one sites. Underneath the tier one sites, there's the actual research institutions. There are many, and they are interconnected in complicated ways. This is a very large system. So how do you actually deal with this complication? How do you let the end users, i.e. researchers, actually operate the systems, access the systems? Well, there's something called the grid, computation grid, where a high energy physicists like Tord Eklöf at Uppsala University wants to run a computation job on CERN data. Well, he writes a job description. I want to run this executable. I need this operating system, this much amount of memory, this runtime. I have these input files, and I will produce these output files. And then he sends them to a workload management system, a kind of a job broker that checks all the various systems and decides to send it to maybe NSE, my previous site, where the job runs. It sucks in data, probably stored on tape, at maybe at Fermilab in Chicago, and the output will perhaps go to disk at Ian de Petroi in Lyon. Altogether, there are about 170 sites in 42 countries and about a million compute cores. So security is kind of important here because not only are the computation resources valuable in themselves, if a bad person gets access to this, they could do quite a bit of damage on the internet just by using the network, all the resources. So what about security? Well, each region in this collaboration has 1 to 2 security officers. Some of them form a group called IRTF, the Incident Response Task Force, which I used to lead. It was quite interesting. It was about 10 people in a global distributed team. Many languages, many different cultures. It was really fun. And we had lots and lots of security incidents because, well, from 170 sites, everything rippled up to us. And of course, there were security incidents. But there were kind of, okay, somebody stole a password and logged in via SSH, local things. Nothing really related to the global infrastructure as in itself. Until 2014, in January, when site admins at B&W Pertois in Lyon discovered that a number of running BLAST jobs, a proteomics software submitted by a French user that we will call Paul, because that's his name, were behaving strangely. They were doing integer calculations instead of floating point calculations, which you would expect. So that was weird. So they took a look at the binary itself using lead methods like running strings on the binary. And oh dear, this is a Bitcoin miner. It's not supposed to be running on our supercomputer. Looking back in, in accounting, there were 35,000 jobs, individual jobs that have been submitted over a couple of months, several different sites, about 100 CPU years, at a cost of about I think I'm missing a zero there, actually. Well, the electricity and cooling and stuff for these were quite a lot. He had made an order of magnitude less money from the Bitcoin than it cost to run the resources. But of course, he didn't pay for the electricity. So we followed our procedure, suspended Paul's grid access since it was apparently compromised, sent out an alert, look for strange jobs, and yours truly was appointed incident coordinator for this. And this was sort of, this is the first real grid incident. So imagine klaxon sounds and red flashing lights. The computer that had sent these jobs was inspected by the local sysadmin at that site. It turned out that the sysadmin was actually Paul himself. He sort of moonlighted as the institution's system administrator, apart from being a biochemist. He found that the computer was compromised. It had various malware installed, including a rootkit, and had logins from China in the logs. So he proceeded to say, OK, sorry about this, case closed. Well, I wasn't totally happy with Paul himself investigating this. So I wanted to check for myself. So I wanted access to the compromised machine, or at least the disk image. And for me, sitting in Linköping, Sweden, convincing people in France that they should send me forensics data is maybe not so easy all times. But you know, the people joke about French bureaucracy. They're all true. This is the structure of the French research and educational structure. There are multiple different ministries involved, for instance. Information security is under the Ministry of Economy, but IT security is under the Ministry of Education, just to start with. So this took a few days, but eventually I was actually sent a 19 gig disk image, and I had a nice grid infrastructure to transfer the data. And I started looking at it. So what do? Well, you look at the file system timeline, and you look at the system logs. So we need to talk a bit about file systems. This is a sort of simplified model of a file system, a typical file system in basically any operating system. You have directories where you have the names of files. to the left. They have pointers to inodes, a data structure which contains the metadata about the file, things like the owner, permissions, and various timestamps. There are many different timestamps, usually, depending on the file system, and eventually pointers to the actual contents of the file, which lives separately in different disk data blocks. Okay, so timestamps. Well, there are typically, well, the three sort of fundamental types of timestamps are that you deal with in Linux and Unix is mTime, that's the modification time of the file, the last time the file contents changed. You have the cTime. This is confusing. You have both modification time and change time. cTime is change time. That's the last time either the file contents or the inode changed. So contents or metadata, that's cTime. And aTime, the last time the file was read. Important piece is that mTime and aTime can easily be set to any value. You just used bin touch. But cTime can't easily be changed. There's simply no API for it. It's supposed to be kind of tamper-proof. Okay, so when you have all, well, to generate the timeline of the activity on the file system, you grab every single timestamp in the file system and sort them into one big list. This is lots of data. Lots and lots of data. I mean, 19 gigabytes of data, many thousands of files, and you get at least 3 timestamps per file. So lots of data. But, well, you learn to find the interesting bits. And there wasn't much to find, actually, in all this data. One can establish that on November 29th, the previous year, the system had been installed. That was a Friday, I think. So the next week, we see the first user activity. Paul logs in, sets up the environment for submitting grid jobs. And then, just after he logs out, there's malware popping into existence in the file system with no trace of how it actually got there. And this is a bit disappointing, but that's how it is sometimes. The timeline is only gives you a limited view of what has happened because if anybody has touched those files later in history, I mean, you only see the last timestamps, so it's a limited view. And on January 9, the system was shut down for the last time, and not much else to be found in the timeline. So we look at logs instead. But I mean, this is presumably a root compromised system. Can we really trust the local logs on the computer? Well, it's hard to say, but you can at least look for obvious signs of tampering. We want to try to build a narrative of what has happened to this system. How did it end up in this state? Try to take all your observed data and put it into a story that seems credible and that explains everything about it. As you know, security-related events are logged to var log secure on a Reddit type system. And to stop it from growing too big, you rotate it. And you know the log rotation process. You have one live log file, var log secure, and then you have archives, a number of archive files with the older logs. And then once a day or once a week or once a month, you rotate them. So you remove the oldest file, you rename the second oldest file to the name of the oldest file. So you end up with this. You see it. You do this whole chain. In particular, this means you rename every file. Every log file is renamed when you do the rotation, which means you change the metadata, which means you get the cTime update for every file. And since this is a fast process, the timestamp should be the same within a second. And the time of the last rotation. So what were the Z times for these rotated log files? This isn't close to being the same timestamp on these files. This is very, very weird. There's no easy explanation. How could we get into this state? How could the Z times end up in this way? It doesn't make sense in any way. In fact, this is actually where I realized that, okay, something is really weird. I can't explain this. There is something very strange going on. Okay, but timestamps are weird. Okay, but let's look at the contents of the logs. Remember, there were logins from China? Well, they were there. Root logins from a particular IP address, which is allocated to China. But at the time, it wasn't routed. It hadn't been taken in use. There's no way you can make a TCP connection from that IP address to the computer in France. Weirder and weirder, this log line is obviously totally fake. So at this point, is there any trace of truth left? Is this just lies, all of it? Okay. Can we find something that has not been tampered with? What about deleted files? Well, what happens when we delete a file in a Linux file system? Well, this is the same picture as before. What happens when you delete the file is that you simply remove all the pointers, zero them out. All the data is left, but you can't puzzle it together. To be able to reassemble the file, you need to get back those pointers to the data blocks. So we must find an old copy of the inode. But how can we do that? Well, let me sidetrack for a moment. In this deletion operation, we change a lot of pointers in the file system. What happens if the computer crashes in the middle of this update? We will end up with an inconsistent file system. That's a bad situation. So in modern file systems, there is a data structure called the journal, where every write operation is recorded. This is, a sort of simplified model of how it actually works. But basically, it's a list of records saying that I intend to write this data to this disk sector, and then the computer does the actual write operation, and if it was successful, it goes back and checks that off from the journal. So this, if we are lucky, there may be a copy, an old copy of the inode still sitting in one of the old journal records. If we are lucky, there are tools for doing this. X3 undelete and similar, which I obviously tried, but didn't find anything interesting. I figured that maybe the tools are failing. Let's do this by hand instead. So I extracted the journal and took a look at it, and that was kind of surprising because it in the middle of the journal it started containing timestamps for each record. At the time, that was a really new feature in the Linux kernel. It wasn't present in the 2.6.18 kernel that the computer had been running. So that was kind of what? And you know what else? The computer was shut down on January 9. How can we have timestamps saying January 10 in the file system journal? When I did a double take and checked the timeline again, I realized that, oh, actually, there are records at the end of the timeline that actually says January 10. So I could confirm it that stuff had happened. Also, the super block of the file system has a timestamp saying when was the file system last mounted. and that also said January 10. Even if you mount the system, the file system read-only, that timestamp is updated. Okay, so let's look further at the rest of the file system journal. Now, this is really strange. Again, I mean, these records are created sequentially. The timestamps are supposed to increase monotonously. Time is supposed to just go in one direction. But actually, they were jumping all over the place. This is starting to get almost spooky. What the F? And finally, cross-checking all the data once more, the weird timestamps in the journal match the points in time where malicious artifacts had appeared on the computer. So there is only one narrative that fits all the facts, that on January 8th, malicious jobs were discovered. Okay, so Paul shut down the machine on January 10. But on January 9. On January 10, somebody that had physical access took the disk and mounted it on another Linux system with a newer kernel and started writing data to the disk. And to sort of try to make everything look correct, he changed the system time back and forth on the computer while doing the writes. That's why we have all these really weird C times and why we have the really strange journal. So this was, as far as I can tell and as anybody else can tell, this is actually the truth of what happened. Did Paul get convicted? Is the next question, of course. Well, I sent a report to the French university. They had a three-person committee that evaluated it very carefully. They agreed on the technical evidence, but they didn't agree that they could indicate one single person who had performed this, even though it was only Paul that had that physical access. So they didn't agree that it was him and wouldn't go to the police with it. Why? Well, the committee consisted of an IT security representative, information security representative, and a local representative. Paul. So no, he didn't get convicted, but I take it his science career hasn't been doing great since this point. So what is the takeaway? What is the point of all this? What do I want you to take home from this? Okay, first of all, don't try to steal CPU time from a supercomputer. It may be tempting, but those are actually basically the only kinds of computer in the world where people are actively monitoring CPU usage and will react if things look strange. Go for office computers or something instead. Secondly, and more importantly, is that it's to credibly fake complex digital evidence is really, really hard. Some of us know this. If you have done a forensics training, for instance, and you want to create training materials and make it look good, that's very hard to make it all consistent. When I do that, it always ends up with somebody in the training coming up with, well, why does it say Nixon owns this file in the training material? And that's actually a positive thing. Because in this age of disinformation and claims that, oh, no, it's just a false flag operation, it's not Russia, it's Ukraine, or whatever. You can actually find the truth, even if it's just digital data that can be easily manipulated. you can still find truth. And that's something which I find makes me feel a bit more optimistic than usual. That's it. Thank you very much.
All right, thank you very much, Leif. I don't know if we have questions from the audience, but maybe we have like 1 minute for it.
Actually, we mostly have comments, but like they should have mined Monero instead.
Yeah.
Ah, that doesn't exist back then.
1,000 comments, like, why didn't you do this? You should have done this. You should have done this.
Yeah, we also shut down his mining pool account, so he probably lost his Bitcoin.
I have one relevant question. Would it have been better to just wipe all the logs and try to wipe the disk before sending it to you?
Yes, but it would have. But he had already told us the fake story with all the SSH logins and stuff. So he had to, when I insisted on getting the disk image, he sort of had to recreate his story. Okay.
Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I'll be around.